Welcome to the DePIN State presented by Eclipse. I'm Nick Hawks. On today's episode, we have Andy, the founder, one of the founders over at DIMO on. This episode is sponsored by Eclipse Labs. If you're pushing the limits of what's possible on chain, you should build your own roll-up with Eclipse. I have a little bit more on them later in the show. Before we get started, remember to hit the like and subscribe button. This alerts you to when the next episode drops and helps us keep bringing great guests like Andy to you. Andy, welcome back to the show, man.
Thanks for having me.
I'm super psyched to have you here. It's always good to have a sharp mind on the show. Let's talk a little bit about what's going on with Macaron. First, correct my pronunciation there.
Yeah, Macaron is good. Macaron is a slightly different type of pastry. And then you have Macron, who's the president of France. But we're going with Macaron.
Okay, with Macaron. Right on. And you guys... Name, you were telling me you name all your devices after dessert. Is that, that's right?
We started with the AutoPie, and we have a nickname for the software connectivity that gets established. We call that soft serve. And we have a couple more devices that we've got in various states that are also codenamed with types of desserts. So I think we're going to stick with that and see how far it takes us. Macaron is nice because it has car in the middle of it too. So.
We'll keep it sweet. I like it. Let's see. So this thing is a $99 device, so cheaper than the AutoPie by a lot.
Yeah, a third of the cost and a third of the size was the design spec. And we've packaged it up so that it looks, you know, it's ready to sit on shelves. And this is a consumer grade device. Plugs directly into the port, so you don't need a cable, any kind of complicated installation. And the first version is using the Helium network. In the future, we might be able to add some versions that have a 4G SIM card, other connectivity options. But this version is going to offload data every 30 seconds over the Helium network, and also will connect to your phone that has the DIMO mobile app on it to be able to transfer data more frequently than that. And it has a bunch of storage on the device, so you'd be able to store about 2 weeks worth of driving data at a minimum. Likely much more than that, and it has a USB-C port on it as well. And yeah, you can go pick one up today at shop.demo.zone, $99, and you will be one of the first people to get one in November, maybe December, if you order today. We've had a bunch of pre-orders come in, and we're stoked to get this thing out there. It's going to be an awesome way to get more people on the network.
Super cool. Now it's a third of the size. If I'm like Max and I've got a fancy car and I don't want a big giant device banging in there, can I trade it in and get the small one? Or are you guys just saying, hey, just go ahead and buy the new one and go for it that way?
Yeah, we're not doing any kind of trade-in program. I would say the $99 price point is designed to be something that's a little bit more of an impulse buy, also something that you can use to like connect the whole family. You know, the AutoPie is still going to have a great place in the lineup of devices because it has some other capabilities and functionality that the Macaron won't, like the ability to create a Wi-Fi network for your vehicle. It, you know, obviously has 4G connectivity. AutoPie owners also get to, we announced a partnership with Coverage Critic a couple weeks ago where they're using data specifically from the AutoPie, so there'll be more rewards associated with that device for some applications, some exciting stuff that we're working on related to mapping out the Helium network, and it may be a fun set of features that will be available just for people who have a Macaron in their car as well.
Super cool. And then this thing's running just on Helium. I think you mentioned it, but just to make sure we put a little bow on that. What happens if there's not Helium network in your area?
The nice thing about the IoT network is that it's pretty easy to add coverage. And that's certainly something that, you know, we expect a lot of the early adopters will be able to do. And in our early testing, it's been cool to see, you know, because we have these devices in motion around the world already, like we're able to see where there's, you know, actual real reliable IoT network coverage. Yep. And we have some distributors that are also working on bundles, so you can buy a hotspot along with the Macaron device. Cool. And then for people that, you know, are going on a long road trip, like all the data will still be stored on the device and you can offload it over your phone. So it's going to be kind of like a Fitbit for your car, and that if you have your phone near the device, they'll be able to link up over Bluetooth, and you won't even really notice whether the data is being transmitted over LoRa or via the phone.
Okay. Now, let's see, data on the Helium network. I mean, it's cheap, but it's not free. How long is the data going to be covered for, and who pays for that?
Yeah, so we targeted, you know, a lot of these devices that are out there today. Like, you can go on Amazon and find something that looks similar to this and, you know, has its own kind of like proprietary app associated with it. And typically those devices are somewhere between like $89 and, you know, on the high end, sometimes a little bit over 100. The thing about those devices, though, is typically they come with a SIM card and a subscription that runs you anywhere from $8 to $15 a month. Mm-hmm. And in our case, we're baking in 3 years of connectivity. We bought the tokens in order to create the data credits and kind of lock in that price already. And did the math and figured that we could make a device that's really competitive on not just the upfront cost, which we've done, but you know, certainly in terms of the operating costs of the device over time. And that's the real advantage of the IoT network, is that you know, you buy an $89 device, but it has a $10 a month subscription, and 3 years after that, you're you know, $450 in. So in our case, we're going to be able to blow that out of the water. And it also comes with the DIMO mobile app and also an increasing number of other applications built on the network that are just going to keep getting better over time. So we see a lot of, like, you know, compounding advantages to the approach, not just in terms of, you know, building on the Helium network, but also, you know, starting to open up the developer platform and have more people building fleet applications. There's some cool games that I've seen people starting to mess around with, a garage app to be able to manage your whole fleet on the web. All that stuff is coming in the next couple of weeks, and in a lot of cases is already out there.
Super cool. Yeah, it's neat to see how people are using it, whether they're a singleton miner or running a fleet of them. Are you guys projecting that the lower cost is going to lead to more purchases in the Macaron versus the AutoPi, since people only care about mining, typically do the math on how fast they can earn back their dollars in tokens? You guys seeing that or predicting that?
You know, I think a lot more so than other projects like DIMO in the, like, DePIN, TIPIN space, whatever you call it, The average DIMO user is a lot less concerned with things like ROI, or they, at least they consider ROI in like a broader context of what does it cost to keep my car on the road every month. And as we see more applications getting deployed on the network that have like exclusive discounts and services associated with them, that gets factored in just like the token rewards do. Yeah. And so in our case, like, we're really thinking of the token as like, you know, Delta Sky miles for your car. And that's a way for people to, you know, capture value from participating in the network. And that's increasingly going to be focused a lot more on the marketplace. And then, you know, also these aggregated data sharing use cases that if people opt into them, like, you know, with Coverage Critic or, you know, the Helium mapping program, like those kind of things will also factor into the value you get out of a device once you plug it in, and will be optional to participate in, but something that I think a lot of people are going to take advantage of.
Okay. Okay. And then regardless of ROI, are you seeing the value of the AutoPi just doesn't bridge the gap in price versus the Macaron? Is the Macaron just going to be good enough for most people?
It depends. I mean, if you're in a major city where there's great Helium coverage, then the Macaron will be a really good option for you. And if you're a fleet operator that wants to have a dash cam and Wi-Fi in your vehicle, and you're less price sensitive on the upfront side of things, then the AutoPi is going to be a great option. We've also, you know, explored even more expensive devices that have integrated screens and, you know, open pilot compatibility. And there's devices out there that, you know, I think might even be able to fill like a higher price point, you know, somewhere in the like $500 to $1,000 range. And so, you know, the goal and the reason we built DIMO to be completely open is that we want hardware manufacturers that have products that provide value to people to be able to connect. And we don't have a whole lot of opinions around, you know, what price point or feature set they should target. And in the case of the Macaron, like, we're, you know, working with a manufacturer that has already produced hundreds of thousands, millions of these devices, you know, for other use cases. And so there's a pretty well-established category in the market that this device fits into, and we think we're solving a really big problem, which is the subscription cost over time. And the rest of the features around it are just software, and that's going to keep getting better and better over time as there's more apps and services plugged in.
Yeah, you guys, it's a smart crew, and you guys are crushing. Let's take a quick break and talk about today's sponsor, Eclipse Labs. One of the cool parts about doing this show is that we get to talk to tons of projects across the space, including the back-end nerdy stuff that helps DePIN projects. One of those is today's show sponsor, Eclipse. They are a customizable roll-up provider with deploying app-specific chains for several DePIN projects. They allow you to pick your virtual machine, your base layer, and additional customizations to enable new functionality for your DApp. Eclipse is committed to helping projects build on DePIN. Check them out at eclipse.builders. And the interview that we did with Neil at Eclipse, if you haven't already seen it. Ripping. So let's see, what do we got next? How's the network growth looking right now, kind of month over month?
Yeah, it's going pretty well. We just crossed 25,000 cars in the last week or so. And, you know, we had really been ripping for a few months there and have taken a little bit of a step down in terms of like the week over week growth. But I think a lot of folks are also kind of anticipating the launch of the cheaper device. And so I think that's something that we're going to start to see turn around towards the end of the year as far as the trend goes. Like for a while, we were adding, you know, over 1,000 cars a week, and it hasn't been close to that in the last week or so. But yeah, we're very long-term focused and, you know, really trying to solve the biggest problem in you know, that has been reported to us by users, which is either have a car that can't connect or your existing device is too expensive. So getting over that hump and shipping this device out to the first couple thousand people that have ordered it, and then getting it onto retail shelves and starting to ship more of the fleet functionality, it is going to be a really big unlock for the remainder of the year here. And I think at the beginning of next year, we're going to have a lot of announcements coming out around people actually like building on the network. And the most exciting thing for us is when we get the flywheel going, where 25,000 users connected to the network makes developers want to show up and build apps, and the apps make more users want to show up and connect to the network. And
nice.
So those are the, you know, those are the things that we're really focused on, rather than looking at the, you know, week over week growth of connected vehicles.
Okay. Awesome. Well, you beat me to the question of how big the network needs to be. Sounds like 25,000, you guys start to really crush there. So that's cool.
Yeah. And I think, you know, with developers, like the real proof point for them is getting to, it's not necessarily that there are so many vehicles on the network. Like certainly 100,000 would be better than 25,000, but really what a lot of them care about is the ability to add that incremental vehicle and give themselves the ability to, you know, with a $99 device, start getting real-time data from a user of their application, you know, somebody who's building a fleet management application, having that really low price point to connect any vehicle, as well as the existing user base is really what people are showing up and are interested in. And so now the goal is just make it as easy as possible for them to build. And we're going to be adding some folks to the team that are, you know, specifically focused on developer relations and have built large you know, communities of applications around fleet management platforms. And a lot of these exist already. They're just very closed. And so that's, you know, a big problem that I think we're going to be solving here in the next couple months. And you'll see the results of that in 2024.
Awesome. It's good to look forward. I mean, I know we're in the kind of bottom of the bear here and then starting to climb out. So it's neat to see you guys just crushing on that. Let's see.
It's the best time to build stuff.
Yeah. Heck yeah. Yeah. You're crazy if you're not building right now. Dude, if you could snap your fingers and give DIMO a number of vehicles connected to the network that's above 25,000, what's the number that gets you super excited where you're like, this unlocks stuff that nobody has ever seen before?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, there's 1.4 billion cars in the world. And so there's, you know, a huge potential number of vehicles that could be connected. And, you know, I think one of the things I've been surprised by is the extent to which people are willing to show up and build on the foundation, even at 25,000 cars. And so that's actually kind of a luxury because, you know, for us at least, like it allows us to iterate and build with a lot of these teams without a whole bunch of noise that is created by, like, you know, in when Helium went from, you know, 10,000 hotspots to a million in 18 months or something like that, it created a lot of unnecessary noise and I think also created a situation where the intent of the network and like the actual usage was drowned out by a lot of the, you know, speculative nonsense. And so, you know, in our case, like, I certainly would love to have 100,000 cars on the network in, and I think that's something that, you know, we'll be able to get to in relatively short order, like certainly next year. I think that's a number that we'll be able to check off the list, but really our focus is on making sure that the incremental car getting added to the network is doing something useful for the network as a whole, and that we're properly incentivizing people. And so, you know, there's definitely a lot of focus on the application layer and making sure that we're plugging services in and that that users who are connecting are having a really good experience and are able to, you know, generate fees and complete transactions that support all of the other great stuff that's going on. So that's, I don't know if that's a direct answer to your question, but that's how we think about it.
No, that's great. I really appreciate coming on. Last question. Is there anything else that you see someone building on the network that you're super pumped about kind of coming down the pipe that might be really cool?
Yeah, there's some stuff I can't talk about. I mean, we've definitely seen some cool, we've seen some cool experiments with a lot of the new AI tools and DIMO data. And so, you know, we have that built in. You know, one way that you can experience that today is by using the error code feature on the mobile app, which will also work with the Macaron as well. And so that's one of those, like, you know, very practical applications of these large language models that are starting to get out there. But one of the things that's becoming increasingly clear is that, like, having your own, like, private repository of data about these things that you own is going to be really valuable in this AI future, because then these assistants will have more context about your life and can help you solve problems and connect with service providers or, you know, take care of things like before they can become problems. And so I think there's a whole really interesting class of applications that are starting to come out there. And then I've also seen some demos of, you know, because all of the vehicles and devices on DIMO have on-chain addresses, you can create front ends for them that are tied to things like QR codes. So like you can put a QR code on the windshield of your car and also on the inside of the car. And if it's a rental vehicle, somebody can scan it and get information about that car and start to use an app. And like, I've looked at a lot of the, you know, progressive web apps that are coming out. And I feel like that's kind of starting to become an unlock as far as onboarding users. And so, you know, you look at something like FriendTech, which is like a complete, you know, social network built in a progressive web app. And then I've started to see folks building DIMO connected PWAs that allow you to like have a really, really simple onboarding experience if you're not already a DIMO user. And so that's the kind of stuff, as we open up the developer platform, it's going to become easier and easier to build. And it solves real problems for people that are like, you know, Turo hosts or trying to share their vehicle, or you're a mechanic and you want to keep track of the cars that you have in your lot. And, you know, so those types of things are going to start to really take off next year. And we've seen some pretty cool early examples that you can, you know, follow along with if you're a developer. Hop in the DIMO Discord and we'll get you pointed in the right direction so you can start using the APIs.
Nice. Nice. A couple little nugget teasers buried in there. Well done, sir. Andy, it's always super good to talk to you. Super good to see how sharp you are and how hard you guys are charging.
Yeah. All right, cool. Well, hopefully it won't be too long. Later, guys.